3 right now. You can tell he's on fire, and I always say this, you can just tell by the way players move.
I first started playing professionally in H1Z1 back in 2017.
So Parpy bumping way up
Parpy
as well.
Bumping up there as well, getting that second place, putting into the gold AR position.
Then I decided to move on to Fortnite. H1Z1 was pretty much just dying, and we saw the potential in Fortnite and just decided to put all our time and effort into it. Told anyone about my gaming life other than my close like best friends in school, because they played games as well and they would understand. And then basically when I qualified for a World Cup with Volks, they just started spreading it everywhere in the school, and then the whole school pretty much knew that I played professionally.
I don't really know how to start off, but my dad at the time lived in Palestine. He was the captain of the Palestinian military, while me, my two older brothers and my mom lived in Baghdad, so we didn't really get to see him much, other than when he made the occasional visits and stuff. One day, my oldest brother Ibrahim was on his way to school as three cars stopped him and had kidnapped him. It was militiamen that kidnapped him because they thought he was someone else they were looking for. They beat him pretty badly and hit his shoulder with the back of an AK-47, which ended up dislocating it. He ended up hitting the guy guarding him in the face because he was distracted on his phone, and he ended up running away to my auntie's house because the militiamen knew where we lived, so it wasn't safe for him to come back to our house. Basically, he was bouncing around houses until he was safe. So when my dad heard of the situation, he and my mom knew how bad the war was getting in Iraq and how corrupt everything was. And he and my mom had decided that we should leave the country and find peace somewhere else. So they decided that we should go to Cyprus, which is a Middle Eastern country which was really good at the time and was peaceful. So we sold our house in Baghdad, and my dad flew in from Palestine straight to Cyprus and got an apartment there and waited for us to fly in from Baghdad. So, as we were at the airport, I don't remember exactly what it was for, but we were stopped. They ended up putting us, for me, my mom, two brothers, in jail. We were in there for around 2 months, from what I remember. At the time, like, I was pretty young still. So they ended up putting me in the female section of the jail with my mom, so that she could take care of me, you know, like, and my two older brothers went in the all male section, which was super packed and legit was like hell to live in. If you were caught with a phone, like money, wallet, any of those type of things, they would just take it from you and beat you up, torture you, like keep you locked up for longer, because the whole system was so corrupt that no one cared, and like there was no policemen that you could rely on. We could hear the men being tortured, like slapped, crying, screaming, and that whole time me and my mom would be super worried that it was my brothers getting hit. They did get a few slaps because they were caught with some money which the policemen stole anyway. Eventually, I don't remember how we got out, because remember I was still like super young at this time, so I didn't know what was going on, but I remember getting out and seeing my grandma and my dad outside waiting for us, which I think they paid a lot of money to get us out. So since they wouldn't let us into Cyprus, our only option was to go to a refugee camp, because we didn't have a house to go back to, since we sold our one in Baghdad to be able to fund ourselves to Cyprus. Basically, we spent like 4 to 5 years in a refugee camp, living in tents without real showers. We had to put like water in buckets and throw it at ourselves. No real toilets to use, and had to like work for clean water. Like any of those stuff you see today, like ovens or any of that stuff, or like any of the stuff you use, we didn't have any of that. It's like watching one of those survival videos on YouTube, but like Arab edition. Throughout all that, we were hoping that we'd get to find asylum in a different country. And thankfully, and I don't even know where we'd be right now if this didn't happen, to be honest, we got news that New Zealand had accepted us, and they were willing to give us everything we needed to start a new life. And you know, like, for that I'm forever grateful, as I'm very lucky to even be alive right now with my whole family. Even after like all that we have been through, I was still like pretty sad when we left the camp, because I'd left all my friends and family behind, and also my 4 dogs, and mainly I had to leave like our home country behind. We flew into New Zealand. We didn't know any English or had any experience of anything. Just to let you know, like, I was 10 years old at this time, and I had not attended school before my whole life. Because it was too dangerous for me to do so. So yeah, thankfully I got like the chance to go to school in New Zealand, and just last year in 2019 I finished my last year and graduated high school. My brothers are both married now. My middle brother ended up getting a master's degree in software engineering, and my oldest brother finished uni as well. I mainly wanted to like come and speak about this stuff because I feel like a lot of people are taking everything for granted, and people need to realize no matter how bad your situation is, there's always people that have it worse, and to always look at the positives and just move on.
Honestly, a big thank you to my mom and dad. Thank you for all the support you've shown me over the years and being there for me. I don't be anything without you guys, and I love you both.